Thus, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We have got a winning Palm Beach. There are some accomplished scholars now, particularly the scholarship of Scotland. Right. Is that one of the interests? Councillor Edward?
Can I declare three interests, by virtue of being a member of the Fire and Rescue Authority, by being chair of New Ferry Village Hall, which is the Lighthouse Premises, and maybe by one of the organisers of the group on the market, press conference.
Give her a lead room.
Which also has off sales of alcohol.
Councillor Roberts?
Me too, being a member of the trial.
Anybody else? Right. Anyone got any interest? Something further? No. Group of notes, last one. Any matters arising on that? No.
Oh, we are getting through this, aren't we?
Eh? Come on. Okay. We have number item three then. We have a street passport with us and your name, sir?
It's Mark.
Mark?
Mark.
Okay. And we'll have the presentation and take questions.
Evening, everybody.
Thank
you, councillors, chair. Privileged to be here. Thank you for the invitation. Thank you, Ian, for the time. So I'm Mark, coordinator for Rural Street Masters. I don't know whether anyone knows too much about street masters in general. Show of hands if you do.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So. I'm along, so what I'm going to try and do is just give you a quick overview of what street pastors do, what they are, and hopefully from that you'll be able to glean some information that's valuable to what you do. My role as coordinator is to try and develop a better relationship between local government, council and the police. So far I've been with the Commissioner of Police, UMPs, Bradfield, Esther McVeigh, Pepper Dean, and met with Emma Degg a couple of times. Try and just bridge the gap between what we do and what we see in terms of on the ground intelligence. So street pastors helped 10 years ago, and they identified a need that people around the nighttime economy are drinking, being drunk, obviously lots of problems relating to those things such as fighting, antisocial behaviour, violence and crime in general. So rural street pastors do very much the same as what other street pastors do all across the country, and we're out during Friday night around the town of Birkenhead, patrolling the streets, making sure people are safe, so particularly vulnerable individuals get home safely. So if a young girl is left on her own, one of our team is available for female and male, so one of our team will stay with them, either bring them on, a friend, or get them into a taxi, making sure that they get home safely. We also give out free flip-flops, ensuring that women who've taken the shoes off don't stand on broken glass or the general filth that's on the floor. And we give a box of water and space blankets to the homeless. And we give out 1 or 2 minutes of drink to try and hydrate them so the taxis that go round in Birkenhead will take them, because 9 times out of 10, because they're so drunk, a lot of the taxi drivers are worried that they'll throw up in the back of the car, so they will take them. So we do what we can to keep them hydrated. Some stats for you, which is probably something you're not quite welcome to hear. The average cost for the NHS for drink-related incidents is £4,000. So for every pair of flip-flops we give out, that means that the person isn't standing on broken glass and isn't requiring an x-ray and isn't costing the taxpayer money. For every fight that's broken up, every antisocial behaviour incident that doesn't occur means that the police can be released to do what they do. We have a standard operating procedure with the police that allows us to engage with people and thus releasing them to do what they need to do. Again, another good thing for the taxpayer. So we deal space wanted to, then we direct them the signposts as like they are. The arch and general other agencies that exist to look after them. And there have been several instances we've been involved with. So somebody had his head stamped on 2 weeks ago, and we stayed with him until the ambulance turned up. And it was fortunate we were with him because he would have been dead within, I would say, half an hour because he was increasing losing consciousness. So we stayed with the ambulance service and then handed over to them. Basically dealt with him. Another chap who was roaming around, we've dealt with him. He was suffering from mental illness issues, and we got him into the back of the ambulance, and he's been now referred, getting back on his medication and dealing with his needs. And most of the time, to be fair, we're just up there to make sure that people are safe and we just have them sitting here. So Ian was out with us, thank you for your time. I'm sure if you want to use Ian as a point of contact, he can share with you on the street information that happened when he was out. But most of the time, we're just engaging with the community, we're engaging with the neighbourhood and the people who are out there like that. There's much more, it's a lot wider than I'm talking about, but I'm aware of a short space of time. So what I'll do is I'll leave it there and take questions on the floor.
Okay, thanks, Mark.
Thank you.
And Jim, you can sit down. Councillor Smith and Councillor Sutter.
Mark, give me permission, but I didn't hear what you said, whether you were connected to any church or anything.
Sorry, I didn't say anything.
That's okay. And whether you were, I'd like you to know. And whether you wear any special gear when you're out at night, any day glove stuff?
Both very good questions. I didn't cover those in the short time. We have a uniform that we have to wear, which is day glove. It's a duotone blue jacket, and that's part of our governance that we have to wear. So we're insured and protected, and that we're identifiable, and obviously the police know who we are. And it's a Christian organisation. It's various churches, it's interdenominational, and it's all different churches across Wirral, and obviously nationally, it's all the same across the land of Lona, with our international thing. So, but it's three pastors, it's the only recognised ministry by the police, and the reason why it's recognised is because we don't go out to, it's not proclamation, we don't go out preaching, we're just there to look after people. And also it's a very highly trained group of individuals, so we actually have police training. Is that the question properly?
Okay, fine. Who
do you get a phone number from?
Oh, we don't. All volunteers pay £300 each to do this. And although it's supported by the Home Office and all our standard operating procedures are signed up by Scotland Yard and the Home Office, that's literally the entirety of where their involvement is. The guys that are meeting with Dave Cameron on a regular basis, the feedback, the national statistics of what's happening and various things, and the funding hopefully should happen, but the funding only comes from what we generate as individuals and also what we get grant applications that like giving to Christian organisations.
Still requires a lot of courage to deal with silent noise.
answer wrong.
I certainly reiterate that, and that really preempts what I'm going to say. Are you in radio contact?
We're from that conversation about there, over there, and in regards to radios, we don't have happened that it wasn't recognised by the CCTV people that we should have radios, despite our request. We have radios between our sub teams that basically communicate, but we send data as part of our own safeguard. It's only on working with them. I think the season is changing in regards to the CCTV aspect, and I think that will change soon. A meeting with the new inspector is next Thursday back to the system.
And the other question I want to ask, so are you using your own long map?
No, we've got a radio between our teams, but there's no actual physical.
So if you're following the emergency service,
yes.
You're following the mobile,
yes.
Has any of your team ever been attacked?
When nationally, I think there's been a handful of instances. One has fallen off, the smoking areas, a ball fell off the shell and hit one of the street passes on ahead. So what we've done to address that is we've done the hard hats and caps, you've got the level hard hats, but it's just because that's the ball goes. But if you look at trend, actually, it addresses the issue. So going 10 years, and there's over 12,000 street passes nationally, and a handful of instances. But locally not. Despite what we get involved in, there's been no aggression to us because we're not police, we're not the doorstep, we're passive, of course. And despite the things that we get involved in, so last Friday I was breaking up a fight with four lads who were beating up another chap. I went in, pulled him off, and told him straight. He wasn't attacking me. Calm down. In fact, very bizarre. You'd expect it to be the opposite, but it's not. Fortunately, it's not. It's because we're a passive presence. People tend to just calm down, and because the uniform is now recognised, we've got the street passes in Shrewsbury being trained by the fire brigade to go in for people who are going to commit suicide. You've got street passes helping people who've been victims of the recent floods. So they recognise nationally, so it's not.
Councillor, I don't know if any of the committee saw the last 12 months of TV programme. So eye opening is in Liverpool Bow Street.
Yeah.
And it started from the homes of the people who were coming out and getting home. If you ever get a chance, have a look at it, because the presentation today is really great, and I hope that the TV programme really opened your mind, because they're in the middle of it all. And it is always, it's a shame that you could have about 15 minutes to say, this is it, from the TV program.
Come out with us.
It's a real Bible.
It's called Angels of Mercy. It was a BBC One documentary about various chaplains and the street pastors that were covered in that. They've got the largest area in Britain that they cover, bigger than London, because each corner of London has their own street pastors. So Liverpool is massive. So yeah, that's that all.
Councillor Roberts, and
after
yourself.
I know you only go out on a Friday night. Is that because you're restricted by numbers? Because Saturday night is probably just as needed.
Indeed, yes, and you are right. The two factors when we set this up was that most of the people who were volunteering, half the amount of the time, were church leaders, and what didn't want to be too weary eyed in the morning. So we didn't just start drolly drafting for Friday. We know actually from the intelligence on the street that Saturday is actually busier. But we're at the point where we need more numbers to our next growth, because some of the other areas, in addition to Birmingham, which is the greatest area indeed at the time, you've got like something right now, which is emerging as a nighttime economy. And I spoke with Esther McVeigh, and she's keen to have some, like some West Kirby and Boyland, and there are other areas, I'm sure, that would chose the Friday. But we would be looking to expand to the new Richard Street right now because of recruits.
Okay, come on. You've identified obviously one of the major problem areas, but then I think you almost answered that question. Other areas which you also identified that you can't cope with it, and you should have got the numbers for that, right?
Yeah, that's correct. Right.
How have you established where these areas are? Is this in conjunction with the police or?
Yes, the police. But what happens generally, like in the preferred heads, they see a hotspot based on the levels of various crimes and things that happen, and so they then say, well, like the preferred, that's the area of need, and it's in conjunction with the police. So what we have to do is, once we have the numbers, we would have a conversation with the police and say, right, New Brighton or Bullock, which ones would you class as being the most prioritised, and that would then expand. Goldwyn will speak past us because we see ourselves covering all Wirral, and the time frame on that, you know, we haven't really got a time frame, but it would be as and when we've got our numbers and we pick. So the police would probably direct us in that case.
Okay. We've got a question about a couple. No? Any more questions?
Good. I think we should reiterate what's been said about the conversion.
Yes,
we
should.
I
did. Yes,
I think we should
work
on the future. Yeah.
Yes, of course. I can remember what we did, and frankly, Councillor Lewis can go on as well, and get involved. How long have you been operating there now?
It's been operating in about just over 2 years.
Have you seen the police? Let me ask them, because if you look at that, we've got a consultation of the street drinking reports, you look at parts of it, and go around Market Street, and areas like that. Close. My question is, does incidents on the decline or the just level?
Violent incidences are on the increase. Really violent, not just fights, ones that I don't go into detail, but in this particular form, I'll plan to do that, which is said in most cases for good intention. But the areas where you identify Market Street, about 3 or 4 venues on that point. And we've noticed, it's been a bit funny because when we first started 2 years ago, a lot of clubs have been closing. Since we've been operating, more have opened. So, Sully's on the Square now is open. One of us is a big, it was a Buzz magazine previously.
Oh, yeah.
And then all have changed names into that Gary Sunshack. So there's others, so when things shut, Kelly Box open and came along. So we're seeing more open clubs, but in terms of the cluster of clubs on Argyle Street, our reports that we produce, the stats to go back to the police and things, identify particular areas that have continual issues and fighting and a lot more problems, should we say.
Well, Argyle Street's especially by the pizza establishment.
Right.
So for some reason the pizza establishment, I think there are more fights go on there than anywhere else in Birmingham, for some reason.
Our reports would support that.
Can I
just ask one very quick question? Do people have a thank you?
Yeah. We have them. We don't actually need to seek people out anymore. People come running over to us. And almost all clear for the clocks in advance now. It's not all doom and gloom, it is nice that they do with buggers. We should have a little tick box now for bugs and high fives. But they do, I mean the people we meet all walks of life generally appreciate the work that goes on. They may not know what it actually means and what we do. I mean, you do get them think we're going out by fashion, and we very quickly explain to them that's not what we do. They also think we're part of the council, so we get a mouthful. And then the doorman very often sometimes comes and sometimes we get away. But once we explain that volunteers and we actually pay to do this, £300, they stop and engage us as well with the community. We have our brilliant at Wetherspoons. Wetherspoons have found recently in the national support of street pastors. As they're now on board, I've got a meeting with Asda soon. As they're nationally our support of street pastors. In a big way. So this is not quite a thing anymore. So more people appreciate it that we're on the ground supporting the community from within.
this committee, and without the eight councils as well, I think it's sort of commend you for organisation for the work you do. And if the licence and fellowship would be of any help for your organisation, I'm sure that you're only willing to do so. I've asked the officer to go the questions and it happens. And thank you very much for your presentation. I thought we'd end with the questions, anyone else?
Should we have a round of applause?
Yes.
Anyway.
Councillor Nathan.
Yeah, I mean, Councillor was quite correct that our licence doesn't just disappear if a fence closes. There can be a whole